Hello, this is Dr. Gary Namey at Workplace Bullying Institute. I'm the director. Welcome to the world of a former bullied individual named Lewis. Lewis is a research scientist. Now, Lewis is going to tell you about his lived experience in his own words. When I sense a teachable moment for listeners, I jump in. But the true value of this Targets as Teachers project at WBI is for website visitors who are unsure about what's happening to them to get clarification and validation from someone who has walked in your shoes and for whom the bullying has stopped. And now, Lewis.
My experience with bullying harassment occurred in the context of academic research, and a number of components of academic research lend themselves to bullying and harassment situations. We think of science as a really hierarchical field. There's a lot of value placed on seniority and experience. And on top of that, there's a tradition that trainees have to, quote unquote, earn their stripes or, you know, earn the right to be accepted into the club of researchers. The sort of central role of scientific debate also creates an opportunity for that debate to go too far and sort of go beyond the boundaries and morph into harassment and bullying. And if we think of kind of the stereotypical scientist and academic researcher, we think that person has good intentions, they're truth seekers, they're fact-based, and all of those sort of combine to lend this idea that, you know, anything goes in academics as long as it's under the rubric of scientific discussion and debate. And in my situation, you know, a lot of those things were utilized to create a bullying and harassment situation. The good news is, you know, that scientific environment also contains a couple of things where I think if a few things fall into place, you know, the target can survive and come out on the other end intact and still with an opportunity to pursue a career. Here are some of the details of what happened to me. I had been part of a team on a long-running research project. It was a large team, senior scientists, junior scientists, and the team included those scientists at different institutions and universities. We were at a position in our project where we needed to submit a funding proposal, and there was some debate on the team about whether we were going to continue on the current path we had been headed down, or whether we were going to take something of a new direction. I was kind of the lead advocate for taking the new direction. And we had a structured conversation with the group over a series of weeks and months. And as we decided how to proceed, the majority of the team agreed on this new path. But even as that discussion was ongoing, there were a few strong and vocal senior scientists who disagreed. So we could tell from the beginning that there was, even though the majority agreed to pursue this path, not everybody was truly on board. And that was a red flag that I noticed, but I probably should have paid more attention to at the time. Fast forward.
Just assume the majority would prevail?
We had an opportunity as a team to vote, you know, which direction are we going to go on? And when we voted, the majority said, let's go ahead and take this new direction and let's have Lewis lead it.
Okay. All right.
And that's the way scientific should work. Science should work. Everyone airs their thoughts, and sort of the majority opinion or the route that everyone wants to go down is the one that's chosen. And that's what we did. And in that sense, it was positive. There were these sort of cracks around the edges that were starting to appear. A couple months later, the funding comes through, and we start this 5-year project. And almost immediately, there were signs that vocal minority really didn't want to cooperate and didn't want to be part of it. And what started as some scientific questions, you know, about specifics and process and details really turned into a series of just roadblocks and skepticism. And by the end of that first year, the debate had escalated from sort of academic differences of opinion to harassment and bullying.
And were there person, did things get personalized? It went from abstract notions of intellectual differences to character assassination, did it, or no?
Absolutely.
It did.
And by that first year, it escalated quickly. As the lead person on the project, I was accused of making bad decisions, of breaking rules about how to spend the funding we had received. I was accused of nepotism and favoring people close to me. I was accused of failing to meet some basic scientific obligations. And the bullying itself took the form of sort of normal scientific behaviors that had gone to an extreme. So there were a number of sort of manufactured crises intended to make our team waste our time with the broader goal of then just getting in the way and preventing us from succeeding.
Lewis, their names are still affixed to the project, though.
They are.
In terms of the funding agencies, they would see that they were part of that. And so if they're actually trying, they're sabotaging their own, they're peeing in their own sandbox. I don't understand. It's interesting, isn't it, that they're still willing to do that. To get at you and the others in the majority, they're willing to actually cast aspersions against themselves.
Correct. And the strategy, as much as we could detect what was going on, was to try to isolate me and my close coworkers and put all of the blame on us and say, look, it's just this one part that Lewis is leading that is doomed to fail. And what you, the funder, should do is really go back, scrap Lewis's ideas, give the rest of the funding to us, and let us control the remaining few years.
So they are communicating with the funder?
Yes.
Around you? Okay. Yes. All right. You're the lead investigator, but they're going around the PI. Unbelievable. Go ahead.
And this is one of those areas where scientific norms can be broken, and those discussions, going around the norms and having the backdoor discussions and making false accusations against me, defaming me to the funders and to my superiors, were all couched in the language of, but we, the senior scientists, know what's best for the project, and what we're really doing is just trying to protect the project, when I think it was clear to everyone that what was really going on was defamation and trying to sabotage the work.
Noble rationalizations. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. And
that's interesting.
And as the target of this, when we realized that this had escalated from normal scientific debate to that kind of harassment and bullying, our challenge is, okay, how can we make that clear to people when it had just sort of, there'd been this mission creep from scientific disagreement, and no one could really point to a specific time when we said, okay, this has crossed the line from scientific debate to harassment and bullying. The good news from my perspective as the target on this is that my team continued to do the work, and with every passing week and month, we were able to demonstrate project success. And then it became harder for those bullies' arguments that this was a doomed project and that there's no way it could succeed. I mean, at some point, the facts just became clear that it was on the right track. And one by one, that vocal minority that didn't really want to be part of the project in the first place, they ended up leaving after it became clear to them that their informal and formal requests to take the project away from me were not going to succeed.
Fantastic. That's so rational, and therefore it's so rare, because this whole phenomenon is so irrational. Mm-hmm. Good. Keep going.
It's rare. And even though you could argue that, the sort of the right outcome occurred and the project proceeded and it wasn't sabotaged, the cost it had on everyone was just tremendous. It put everyone involved in a just incredibly uncomfortable position. The funders didn't know what to do and they didn't know whom to believe. And this is one of the parts of science. When you start a long-term project, you don't really know what the end point is going to be.
And right. So that's the idea, discovery.
Right. And if one group of scientists says, but this, there's no way this is going to succeed. It's a failure. Don't even bother. And another group says, but this seems to be the right track. You have to make those decisions. And it's just, it's a strain on everyone. And it's painful to me to think of how much energy was wasted all along in responding to the false accusations and the defamation and the threats and the interference. I mean, think of what really could have been done if we'd all been working on positive things.
How was the strain manifested in those of you who were in the majority and the ultimate prevailing part of the group? How did that play out? To you personally, for instance?
To me personally, it changed my life. Yeah, it's impossible to fully state how stressful the experience was day in and day out. It was the first thing I thought of in the morning and the last thing I thought of before I went to bed. I tried to compartmentalize it as much as possible, but when you're in the middle of it and you're being targeted and defamed and accused of false things, you want to believe that the truth will win out, but you look across the table and you see, but if these bullies are so bent on making these false accusations, we're sort of past the point of facts mattering. And that was the hardest thing to conceptualize and to accept. It also put a tremendous strain on the rest of the team. And it really forced everyone in an unfair way to pick sides without the team ever going to the rest of the individuals and saying, you need to pick sides. You need to say whether you're with Lewis's group or whether you're with this group. I could see it on the faces of my colleagues when we would have meetings, and it was almost just a fear and an anxiety, and everyone is walking on eggshells.
Yes. That's often the description.
And in research, the concept of sort of peer review is central to what we do. Our peers decide whether the science is on the right track. Our peers help decide who's earned a promotion. And so there is a great deal of caution in sort of sticking one's nose in another person's fight. There's very little upside. And I do remember early on in the process, once I could see where this was heading, reaching out to colleagues who knew all of the people involved here and asking them for help. And I said, could we get your input to help keep the team focused? And every one of them said, no, I'm not even touching this thing. And right. that was informative for two reasons. It reiterated to me that essentially I was on my own. I was going to have to figure out a way to navigate this. And it also told me sort of how, that word was getting out in the community and that this was going to have a long-term effect on everyone's career.
At your host institution, that it was leaking outside your lab. Oh, beyond.
Yeah. And in today, science is, and academic research is so international. It's so team-based. Rarely does a project include just one lab at just one university. And the scientific communities, everyone knows each other. So it wasn't long, even among those people that I hadn't spoken to, pretty soon everyone in the community across the country knew what was going on in this project.
So it played out, it came up at conferences and things outside the project itself.
Oh yeah.
Oh boy, oh boy.
Yep. And that's part, I know this is speculation because I wasn't in their head, but if one of the goals of this kind of bullying is to make the argument that, look, this person, Lewis, he's not a good enough scientist. He doesn't deserve to lead this. Then that leads directly to, well, let's just besmirch his reputation across the whole community. There's no boundary. A means to an end.
Horrible. It's basically the academic version of Facebook. The smear is widely distributed. Yes.
One silver lining from my experience is I do think that the experience gave me an added and beneficial perspective on self-awareness. And
how so?
For two reasons. Within science, you know, even though we think of sort of the independent investigator, and particularly with funding, funding through grants and foundation awards and things like that, there are other people involved in the final decisions. And for our team, the ultimate deciders of sort of which direction the research would go in was our university. Because the funding is awarded to the university, and then the investigators at the university use that funding. So much of the discussion was with the leaders at my university and them having to make decisions. And it occurred to me early on that having those discussions was very different than the kind of academic discussions you have. So my job was to help present the facts and help the university make the best decision.
So you found that those were what, more political?
Not necessarily more political. I want to come back to that one second. One component of them being political is, in academics, rarely is the harasser or the bully going to be fired. You know, in some of the most egregious cases, sexual harassment, racial discrimination, those are obvious. But in circumstances like this, where it's an academic dispute that escalates into academic bullying over project direction, resources, things like that, you know, no one was fired or dismissed in my instance at all, because they still had other projects to do. And from a university standpoint, there's really no benefit in picking sides and saying you're the winner and you're out of here. It just
good point.
It's an unnecessary risk for the university. So I had to think of how can I protect the project and the team without forcing the university to make a decision that they're never going to make. If I had gone to them and said, you must fire the harasser, that's a non-starter. So and that's where the self-awareness comes in. How can I just focus on what needs to get done? How can we preserve the ability to do the work and keep our sanity?
Okay. And the second point?
The second point is, you know, in order to have that conversation, I realized I needed to understand the bully's intention. I needed to think past the false accusations, because it was easy to see those weren't true and the defamation wasn't true. And so then it was a chance to think, all right, what's really motivating them? And in our instance, it was clear that, you know, they didn't want to change. They wanted to keep going in the previous direction. And that's a rational decision. And the more I understood that, the more I then could focus and say what's the saying? You can't ever really change someone's mind. You can just kind of understand where they are and kind of live with it. So we move past the point of trying to get them quote unquote on board, and then just said, what's the best kind of detente that we can try to end up with so that everyone gets out of here sort of alive and in one piece, so to speak.
Did you arrive at that point, do you think?
We did. And I did. I came across a couple things that I think anyone who's in an academic bullying position can think about as they try to navigate it.
Okay.
In addition to trying to understand what, you know, the bully's intentions are, but a couple things, you know, protect your team. As one of the project leads, I was in a position where I knew we had to keep doing the work. You know, the facts would speak for themselves. And that meant I had to find ways to shield my team as much as possible from all of the negative stuff. It was hard, it was constant, but it was essential. I also had to identify a couple of key, what I call lifelines. And there were a few trusted people who were outside the project and they were outside the decision makers. They weren't directly involved, but they were people whose opinion I trusted. And I went to them early on and I said, you know, I'm in this situation, we're facing this. Can I call you if I really need advice on a particular thing? And they said, yes, thank goodness they said yes. Now I didn't rely on those people often and I never really identified who they were. So they were able to sort of do it in secret. But having the ability just to step back and call a trusted objective person who isn't involved and get their feedback. On a couple times when I did that, it really was essential. So I would say, you know, develop your network and, you know, ask people for help.
That's now, did they do your type of work, or are they simply familiar with you more on a professional or personal level?
They were at the, well, both are important. These were at the professional level. Okay. They didn't do exactly the same kind of work that I did. They weren't involved in the project. We don't work together on projects, but I had seen them, and I'd come over the years before to really respect them as professionals. And it's a different, I think of it almost as kind of a bullying mentor. You know, I needed a mentor on how to survive the bullying experience, and they provided that. You talked about personal help as well, and I was probably a little too late in on my own personal time going and getting some other professional help. Everyone needs to have an outlet. You know, as much as this weighs on a target 24/7, I had a few things that I was able to use to kind of give my mind a break. I wish I had been even more proactive than that. And this is, I think, the final bit of advice I would give to anyone who's in an academic bullying situation. I was hesitant to name it as harassment or bullying early on because, you know, you want to give people the benefit of the doubt, and because that line between scientific dispute and bullying is not clear. In hindsight, I should have been more proactive in bringing up that term earlier. So I would say, if I could go back and do it again, I would have raised those terms early on, because I think it would have helped frame the discussion, and it would have put in everyone's mind, you know, is this something that's crossing the line from discourse and disagreement to bona fide bullying? And so I would, as much as I know it, you know, I can imagine how hard it would be for someone to utter that phrase the first time, but I think the sooner you can bring it up, the better chances everyone will have to take an objective look at what's going on.
And I will tell you, one of the first things that we do as I begin the training for professionals that we call Workplace Bullying University is saying, glad you're here. It's in the title. It's in the name of our work group. We've been doing this 23 years, but forget bullying. I think you should name it some form of violence or interpersonal. Don't call it conflict. Don't call it disrespect, but escalate it. And make it, and therefore, that's why we've settled on abusive conduct or exploitative relationship would fit very well in the academe. But you're right. The sooner you name it, you give people a license to consider it something abnormal and unacceptable, as opposed to that, as contrasted with the intellectual differences, which we not only expect, we want.
Yep.
Yes, I agree. Isn't it interesting you say that? The quicker the naming. And it's better for you personally, because anytime it is named, it externalizes the phenomenon so that you don't somehow turn toward yourself. I'm glad you turned toward an exploration of the perpetrator's motives, as opposed to what is it about me that made this happen? And that's the typical target term. So maybe that's where your own intellect served you well. You knew you did nothing wrong, and you were correct in your role, and you had done it respectfully, and you had let the other voices be heard, and you actually, by taking a vote, meant you, prior to that, you had had the discussions. I think you did everything well there to externalize it, but you still had that incredible strain of stress. Did you ever get counseling?
I did.
Good.
And this is the other lesson I would really encourage anyone in an academic environment to think of. When, after a couple of years, it became clear that the bullies were moving on to other projects, and we had quote unquote won, although no one can ever really win in a situation like this, but we had prevailed, that's a better word. I distinctly remember coming into the office one morning and being so angry at what had happened and all of the energy wasted. And I thought, why did we have to go through all of this? And I caught myself thinking, I can't do my job right now because I'm so angry. Mm. And I walked over to the health services building and I told them what was going on. And that started the process of getting some help. And it was, you know, it's still emotional for me because it was a point where, you know, we were past it. And a lot of people on the outside would say, but it's over. You survived. Now you can do the work. You know, there's a long tail.
No, you still need to grapple with what had happened. Yes, I agree.
And so that's where I think it's not a fun realization to make, but to anyone who finds themselves in this situation, I'd encourage them to think, okay, it's going to be a long-term process and plan for the short term and plan for the long term. It's never just going to sort of get wrapped up and turned off.
Now, and what about the stability and safety? And targets who are listening, when I say safety to Lewis, and the safety he would have referred to naturally was he wasn't under physical threat like some of the other targets you're going to hear in this project where they were physically attacked, injured, hospitalized, and disabled. In this case, we're talking about psychological safety. Free from the ridicule, free from the sabotage, free from the personalization and the character assassination.
Yes. Yes.
That's nice. That's
there were a few screaming matches where in the same room, you know, people, they leaned forward, got very close, sort of violated personal space. And it came to a point where I said, I don't want our team in the same room as some of those other folks because I can't guarantee their safety. And that was being cautious. But mm-hmm. you're right. It was the name calling, the harassment. There were legal threats silly lawsuits. But that's a technique that often comes up saying, well, we're going to sue you. And, thank goodness it wasn't physical violence and mm-hmm. there was no sexual harassment, although that's often, you know, a component of this. Thank goodness that didn't surface here. But those things crossed our mind. And it's impossible not to think, well, if it can get this far, what's next?
Well, that's where you hope that somehow there's a civilization going on, civilizing. And the other thing that really frustrates me very much about the academe is the push toward workplace civility. I mean, civility is really overused in the academe. Mm-hmm. And I wish they would get away from that because, as you've pointed out, there needs to be rigorous debate on intellectual topics and things, because if you're not in the academe because of a passion, you're in the wrong business. Go sell something somewhere. It's. I only have run into the good ones are the passionate ones. I happen to have been passionate about teaching, which always got me in trouble. So I never had the experiences you've had. But vicariously, in the past couple years, I've been called in to deal with very high-profile scientists running multi-million-dollar research teams being accused. And as you said so astutely, the university brings me in, and then they say, but let's be clear, he will not be terminated. I know. He's bringing you $17 million and all the overhead that brings you, so it sustains you and all the deans. So I understand. Five NIH grants? Really? Five? One grantee? So to confront those people has been quite an experience. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that. And you are nothing like those people that I've confronted. So as a PI, you certainly do not have bully in you. And the other ones probably smelled it, saw it as an opening to attempt to exploit, but I think you shut the door on them really, really well with thoughtful execution of a plan. I just want targets to know how rare it is that you can plan as you're being assaulted. what typically happens is targets have to cool down for a year or so when they're no longer under direct assault. Then they get angry. Some feel guilty, and that's wrong, and some feel shame, which is wrong and horrible, but natural. But until they get angry, they don't have the ability to formulate a plan. It's as if their stressed brain is interfering with their decision making. And I wanted to credit you with really good decision making, sounds like, throughout. So you used your rational mind to try and tame this irrational process and make it rational again. So I'm really, really happy that you got through to the other side. Still working on the same field and new grants?
Yes. And
good.
You know, speaking of that,
looking out now, how are you going to take your lessons learned into the future? What do you think? How is it informing your new approaches, if you have any?
That's a great question. You know, we knew when this project started that change management was going to become a part of it. We didn't know it was going to be so essential, and particularly the team dynamics. And now when I talk to other scientists, and again, everything in science is now team science. No one does work truly on her own or his own. Everyone team science. And I was talking to some trainees just last week, and I said, this might sound crazy, but whenever you start a project, I want you to think about the team you're working with. Because some of these scientific collaborations are what I call forced marriages. We don't always get to choose the team we work with. And that's
good
true
point.
In the corporate world as well. Take a moment after you've had a chance to sort of get to know people and see how they operate and assess it. You know, who's going to be a champion? Who might be a skeptic? Who might not really be in it? And it's not for purposes of tricking or deceiving people. It's just more for the purpose of part of operating in that team environment is understanding the team members' motivation and then trying ways to connect with that team member so that they have a good experience and you have a good experience. It really, and that's where I think if there is a silver lining at all, and silver is too much, so maybe just a stainless steel lining. I think that the experience has really, I think, sharpened my interpersonal collaborative skills.
And your self-awareness, as you had said, too. Yeah, yeah.
And so that's where, if someone's at the start of this, if there's someone who's unfortunately facing an academic bullying situation, you know, a couple of high-level things, take a look at what you're facing. Be objective about how to get there. And then I would say if you decide to go ahead and stick with it and push through, that there are some ways that you can come out better on the other end. You know, it'll take its toll. There'll be a cost, but I think there are some ways you can make some lemonade out of the lemons.
Well, I want to commend you for making interpersonal relationships nearly as high a priority as the technical. In regards to how are we going to manage this multi-year, multidisciplinary, multi-institutional working collaboration. And that's only smart. So that's great. Now that'll be something that, in fact, remember you were talking about when you were first trying to think of their motives. Well, people are afraid of change in that. Well, they're really afraid of what they would call soft skills. You never let it be denigrated to the point where it is labeled as soft skills. The interpersonal is always given short shrift. Oh, that's psychological BS, psychobabble. Look, we're scientists and we can deal with this and we do. Well, that psychobabble is going to undo you if you don't pay attention to it. So I'm glad you raised it as an important part of team functioning, because after all, it is team function. And it was groupthink that basically led to the Challenger disaster. And it's hard to get more technically scientific than engineering. And very clear with clear boundaries, explicit outcomes, very measurable things, unlike a lot of other forms of science. And they blew up the Challenger, and it's mainly because of ego. So it came out. And so, yes, it needs to be raised in every group setting. And people need to be, I'm a social psychologist, so of course I think group dynamics are important. But the point is, I know it's underestimated in a lot of fields of endeavor. In this case, you raise a very important point. It's not our bailiwick, but let's pay attention to it, lest it undo our own technical field. We don't want to get unfunded. We don't want the project to collapse. And we don't want these petty differences to somehow override the important work we're doing, and that's why we're all here. So, you know, I can see making that case. Well, last thought, Lewis, I wanna wrap up our recording.
Yeah, what you just said, I think, aligns nicely with some of the changes we've seen in the last couple of years. You know, we're talking here in the middle of 2020. And, you know, think back a couple of years. Me Too, and
yes,
the summer of 2020, emphasis on representation and inclusion and giving more equal voice to people whose voices have not been heard and have been silenced institutionally. I think there are a lot of things happening in the culture and in the professional environment right now that can help make it easier for all of us to recognize harassment and bullying and make it easier for those voices to come out in a way that they don't always lead to bad outcomes. And so I'm optimistic. It'd be great if you could learn all these lessons just in happy situations, but the world isn't fair sometimes. But I'm still an optimist, and I hope our story can provide a little hope for others out there.
Oh, I'm sure it will. And regardless of the source of the adversity, it still triggered the lessons, prompted the lessons. You did well, and thanks a lot.